Go ahead, Phil.
Okay. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Wednesday, June 12, 2024 meeting of the Zoning Hearing Board for the City of Reading. I'm going to introduce the members of the board. Charlie?
Charlie Jones, alternate member of the board.
Jeff?
Jeff Gattone, member of the board.
Tom?
Tom Fox, member of the board.
Bill?
Bill Harst, member of the board.
And I'm Phil Rubina, member of the board. Steve?
Steve Price, solicitor to the board, and with me is Libby Tamora, our associate.
Okay, thank you. Emily?
Emily Diaz-Melendez, zoning office.
Okay, thank you. All right, before we get into our agenda for this evening, there's been a time request for an extension on Appeal 2023-06. That's 118 South 9th Street. And it's Cesar V. Lopez Escalistanco. And it's requesting an extension of time. They're waiting on some permits and some drawings and things like that. So I'm going to make a motion to grant that extension for 1 month. Do I have a second for that?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, thank you. All right, we have one more member of the board that just joined us. And Jared, you want to introduce yourself?
Jared Bartz, member of the board.
Okay, thank you. All right, we have some decisions from last month's meeting. Appeal 2403-0008, which was 1412 Schuylkill Avenue. Mr. Price.
Is there a motion to approve the relief requested subject to the conditions set forth in the written decision?
I'll make the motion. Move.
There's a motion and a second. Any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Okay, so that's unanimous.
Okay, we have Appeal 2404-0009, 1014 North 13th Street. Mr. Price.
Is there a motion to approve the relief requested subject to the conditions set forth in the written decision?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Are there questions or comments on the motion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Ayes have it.
Okay. The next appeal was 2404-0010, 1128 Robinson Street. Mr. Price.
Is there a motion to deny the requested relief?
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Motion and second. Are there questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye to deny.
Aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it.
And the last appeal for last month was 2404-0011, 1900 Hill Road. Mr. Price.
Is there a motion to approve the current three apartment units there and to deny the fourth apartment?
I'll make the motion.
There's a motion and a second. Are there questions or comments on the motion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye to approve the three units, but to deny an additional fourth unit.
Aye.
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 Okay, that's unanimous then. Thank you. That ends those decisions.
Okay. We have Appeal 2403-0005, 1116 Perry Street. Is there an attorney to represent these people?
Yes. Good evening, everyone. It's Todd Mays on behalf of the appellant, and my clients are present in the room with me.
Okay. I think what we'll do is we will swear in our zoning officer and then Mr. Price, then we'll go to you. And any people you're going to have testify, we will have them sworn in at that time. So would you swear in our zoning officer, please?
You swear the testimony about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Has notice for this appeal been given?
It has.
Thank you. Mr. Price.
Thanks. I'll put some exhibits into the record. Exhibit number one is the notice. Exhibit number two is proof of publication of the notice. Exhibit number three is proof of posting of the notice. Exhibit number four is the application, including all of its amendments and attachments. And exhibit number five is the zoning ordinance of the city of Reading as amended. Mr. Mays, why don't you enter your appearance and then we'll deal with your exhibits. Okay, sir?
Yep, thank you. Todd Allen Ryder Mays, Esquire, on behalf of appellant, which is Angel Arizari, who is the president of A&M Management Corp.
And you had sent a packet of exhibits to the zoning administrator. How many of those exhibits did you have?
I had marked six exhibits.
All right, so we'll mark yours six through, I guess, 11. We'll just keep them sequential that way.
Understood.
All right. If you want to do an offer of proof, Mr. Mays, that's fine too by the board. And if they have questions, swear your witnesses in.
Great, sounds good. I'll start with an offer of proof. My client owns the building located at 1116 Perry Street. 1116 Perry Street is located in the R3 zoning district. Out of the building that my client owns, it's a child care center called Danny Lynn's. They've been operating out of that building since 2016. The child care center is currently an approved non-conforming use. They operate during the hours of 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. with an enrollment of approximately 45 children and about approximately five employees. My client is seeking a special exception approval to expand the floor space of the non-conforming use. If granted relief to do so, my client is seeking to increase the load capacity based upon the expanded floor space. My client is seeking special exception variance from the off-street parking requirements under section 600-1603A9. The building is a child care center located on a three-floor building at 1116 Perry Street. It is attached to a church on Perry Street. The entire building itself, which includes the church, encompasses approximately 9,700 square feet. The daycare center currently operates on the second floor and the lower level of the building. The second floor encompasses 2,040 square feet. The lower level is approximately 700 square feet. So in total, the childcare center is currently occupying 2,700 square feet of the 9,700 square feet. The special exception for the proposed expansion. First, my client is looking to expand the first floor room, which is currently unoccupied. There will be no structural additions to it. It is there, it is existing. My client has upgraded the flooring by adding new flooring, has painted the walls, and has added cubicles to that space. That space is 1,660 square feet. They are looking to utilize that room as an additional play area for the children while they're cared for. The second expansion is on the lower level. Again, there is currently 700 square feet that is occupied and approved as a non-conforming use. My client is looking to add 200 square feet and convert that into a nursery, again, by updating the flooring and painting the walls and adding some cribs. So we're looking to expand into the first floor, which is currently an existing space, but not occupied, and then add a nursery to the lower level. Again, no structural changes to that. If granted special exception to do so, again, my client is looking to increase the maximum load capacity. Maximum load capacity currently is 50 children. As far as—
What would it go up to, Mr. Mays?
I'm sorry?
What would the increase be in the number of children taken care of?
So my client is seeking to increase it to an additional 30 children, which would make it 80 children. But certainly we will defer to the board on that.
And let me ask you this one question. Since 2016, there's been no violations either of state or local law with your client, correct?
That is correct. There's been no violations.
I don't have any other questions, but continue. Sorry.
Yep. My next relief that I'm seeking is for the off-street parking requirements. Before I get to that relief, any other questions in regards to the expanded floor space?
Just one quick one. Do you have these expanded spaces been approved by the fire marshal's office? Do you know? Yes,
yeah, it does.
You can make that a condition, Phil, if you were so inclined to approve this.
Okay,
we'll address that. Pass codes and whatnot.
All right.
That's at this juncture, I apologize. I don't know the answer to that question. I'm not sure.
Well, that's all right. We'll address that in another way. All right. Do any other members of the board have any questions of Mr. Mays at this point?
Mr. Rabin, I do have a quick question. Throughout the introduction, you referred to the building. When I looked up 1116 Perry Street, up pops the picture of this beautiful church in which it states on the internet that there is a child care on the second floor. Now, when you're talking about the appellant here, is you said that the, is it next to the church or is it part? Just clarify the building that you were saying at the beginning.
Yep. Sure, thank you. It is actually attached to the church. It is connected to it. So there is a walkway that goes, I'm sorry, good. Yep, thank you, Emily. It's attached to the church, and inside the church, there is a stairwell that connects the daycare center to the sanctuary of the church.
That's it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anybody else have any question? Anybody in the audience have a question of Mr. Mays? All right, please continue.
Thank you. As stated, we're also seeking a variance relief for the off-street parking requirements under section 600-1603A9. Currently, the applicant is utilizing on-street parking on Locust Street and Perry Street. There is a public parking lot that is located on Perry Street. The entrance is on Perry Street, and it's behind the 12th and Marion School District. That parking lot has 34 spaces that are available. During the hours of 7 a.m. and 4:30 p.m., Monday through Friday, it is reserved for the Reading School District employees, but it is public parking at all other hours. Approximately half of the students children who are cared for are within walking distance. It's an urban area. Most of them walk to the location. As far as the employees go, there's currently 5 employees. 2 are within walking distance, 2 take public transportation, and there is 1 individual who does utilize a parking space on Locust Street. The daycare center, and speaking with my client, has a pretty efficient drop-off and pickup, whereby they have somebody dedicated to the front door so that when an individual who is driving is dropped off, they have somebody there to grab that student, help that student safely into the building so that the individual who is transporting that child does not even need to utilize a parking space. So there's very little parking requirements based upon the pickup and drop off schedule that the child care center has. And if needed, they do utilize on off hours the parking lot behind the 12th and Marion School District. There's also never been, since my client has been operating the daycare center since 2016, there have been no parking violations that my client is aware of.
Okay, thank you. All right, any board members have any questions? Mr. Price, any question?
None, Mr. Rubino.
Emily, any question?
No questions. I did want to just, since you asked about the fire marshal, all of that with the fire marshal and stuff will be addressed at the building permit stage. They review all of that.
Okay, thank you. Anybody in the audience have any questions at this point? All right, seeing none, continue, sir.
And that is all the relief that we are seeking.
Okay. So
we'll admit your exhibits. I don't know if there's anybody in the audience who have any questions for the witness's attorney or the applicant's attorney, or have any comments for or against it.
I have kind of one request to make, if you can do it. In some of the exhibits that you submitted to us, there's a lot of hand-drawn drawings, I believe. Do you think somebody could kind of freshen those up and make them look a bit more professional or to some sort of a scale? And if you can get that to us within the next 2 to 3 weeks, get them to Emily in the zoning office, just so that those are a lot clearer than what they are, and that we really have an accurate picture of the dimensions. I think that would be helpful for the record.
Absolutely, I can do that.
Okay. All right, any board members have any questions? One last call. Emily, Steve, none? Anybody in the audience? All right, hearing none, we will close this hearing and we'll issue a decision at next month's meeting. You need not be here. And we thank you very much for your attendance and your information.
All right, thank you all.
All right, the next matter before us is Appeal 2405-0012. It's 901 Spring Street, McDonald's USA LLC, care of Eileen Seeberger, is requesting a special exception for the reconstruction of a non-conforming use restaurant with drive-through facilities and signage, or in the alternative, variances for signage and variances for buffer strips and screening. The subject property is located in the CN Commercial Neighborhood Zoning District, and the owner of record is McDonald's Corporation. Okay, let's swear in Emily first.
You swear the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Has notice for this appeal been given?
It has.
Thank you. Mr. Price.
Thanks. I'll put some exhibits into the record. Exhibit number one is the notice. Exhibit number two is proof of publication of the notice. Exhibit number three is proof of posting of the notice. Exhibit number four is the application, including all of its attachments. And exhibit number five is the zoning ordinance of the city of Reading as amended.
Okay. And I believe you would be represented by an attorney. And are they present?
Their engineer is.
Just their engineer?
Oh, they're sorry. Didn't see you guys.
Okay, thank you.
Who's the attorney?
Pardon?
Me, right here. Charles Sir, Stevenson Lee.
Okay, so enter your appearance, and then if you want to do an offer of proof, sir, that would be great.
Sure. And first of all, I apologize for not exhibits. We were under the impression that this was going to be an in-person hearing, so you're coming in kind of here at the last minute. So we did have other exhibits that we're not going to be able to use tonight, although I would gladly submit them in either electronically or by mail afterwards.
Just submit them in electronically.
I have them, so I can share them if you need.
Okay, there were a couple of new ones, but we'll do without them this evening, which is fine, that you do not have.
So, okay.
All right, so good evening. My name is Charlie Sir. I'm an attorney with Stevenson Lee. Representing McDonald's USA LLC, which is the entity wholly owned by McDonald's Corporation, which owns the property located at 101 North 9th Street within the city. It's about 0.6 acres in zoned commercial neighborhood. It is currently developed with a restaurant with drive-through since about 1982. And the restaurant is a permitted use in the CN district However, the drive-through is not permitted. So it is currently a non-conforming use to have the drive-through portion of the restaurant. So the project that we have is to redevelop the site with a new McDonald's restaurant with a reconfigured drive-through facility, and land development plans will be submitted to the city. The relief that we have here is really related to three different areas. The first is related to the reconfiguration of the drive-through. Since it is currently non-conforming and we are reconfiguring it, we need a special exception to reconfigure the existing drive-through. The second packet of relief is all related to signage, and it's all dimensional in nature. For the signage, related to the area and height of certain freestanding directional signs, the area and height and number of certain directional signs, and most of them are related to the drive-through or the parking areas. And what we've asked for the signage is for a special exception for a reduction in the dimensional requirements, and then in the alternative, a dimensional variance. Finally, we've asked for a relief related to buffering and screening, and that again has to do with the reconfiguration of the drive-through, as well as the upgrades to the parking areas. This is, again, is also reflecting current non-conforming conditions on the property that we are essentially maintaining our property, but we are updating them. So, again, I wasn't participating, expecting a Zoom hearing. Would you like me to continue on with kind of examination of the witness, or can we just do a quick offer of proof based on what we have?
Why don't you do an offer of proof? Because I think everybody's familiar with the site and the constraints on the site and the location near the old Moss Street outlets. And you're not rebuilding the building, are you? Or are you?
Yeah, we are.
Okay. So just let us know, I mean, what would be the major differences between the current building and the proposed building? And I don't know, I'm just going by memory, I don't even think there's buffering there now, correct?
That there isn't much there. Let me have our witness. Matt, why don't you introduce yourself? If we can swear him in, I think it'd be easier if you would just explain that.
All right, thanks.
All right, please raise your right hand. Do you swear the testimony about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
All right, your full name and spell it for the record.
Sure, Matthew, M-A-T-T-H-E-W, and the last name is Chartrand, C-H-A-R-T-R-A-N-D.
Okay, Matt, so there's some questions about really the difference between the existing and the proposed. And we just talk about, you know, the size of the building changing and any shifting and how that impacts the drive-through.
Sure. The overall site's about 0.61 acres. Obviously, you can see you have a site plan that's being shared here right now up there. This is the proposed site plan. You want to start with the existing conditions or the trying to see if you have that. Or the even the aerial or the survey is fine. Here you can see an aerial of the site itself. The building and the orientation here is, you know, plan north is kind of true north the way that you're looking at it. And on that north side of the site, the building is kind of tucked into the corner of that lot. We do have a fairly irregularly shaped lot there that's abutting the residential properties along 9th and Moss. That building and the drive-through, as you noted earlier, are basically up against or very close to the residential properties along North 9th Street. The building itself is about 3,527 square feet. It does, however, have a basement associated with it based on a prior use that this was previously used as a diner, I believe, even before McDonald's was there. So again, the configuration itself that you see does have a dual, what we refer to as a side-by-side drive-through, where there's two different ordering points that then come back together for a single pickup point on that north side of the building. The way that that operates right now, you do have to make kind of a series of turns in order to facilitate getting back to that edge of the building in order to use that. So under the proposed condition, the building itself is, if you go, yeah, go back to the site plan here, the building itself is going to shift a little further south and increase slightly in size up to 4,000, I'm sorry, I'm trying to read that, 4,311 square feet, has 55 seats interior. But hopefully you can see with the drive-through configuration that we have now in this operation would be a little bit more streamlined. We would still keep the dual ordering points, although they would be reconfigured to be aligned along that eastern side of the property. Same, you know, menu boards, same pre-menu boards that are there today. We do need to move those in terms of location, which is something that we'll get into in terms of, you know, the signage application. And then with shifting that building down, we've reoriented some of the parking along Spring Street, which is now going to be at a 60 degree angle. And for the most part, will be one way as you enter off of North 9th towards that drive-through area. I will note that we did go to the Planning Commission as part of a sketch plan application. And there was some discussion relative to the fact that off of Spring, you cannot make a left onto North 9th. So they asked that we reconfigure. We had previously just an exit only driveway out to Moss Street. That driveway was reconfigured to allow for an entrance, which would effectively just be able to service and get into that drive-through. But that way, people on Spring who make a left onto Moss can then enter the site that way. If they were not to use the drive-through, there are two parking spaces that we have down in the southern end of the site along Spring to accommodate them. But again, this was sort of a compromise to make this work a little bit better functionally for a site that just happens to be very tight.
So let me ask one question. I'm looking and I see the cars stacking at the two boards where they would order and then getting into one single lane. The entrance there would be off Spring Street in front of the restaurant, and then it would wrap around the building. Is that how they would get there?
No, there's no driveway access off of Spring.
Or, I mean, North 9th. I'm sorry, North 9th.
Correct. Yes, that would be the primary entrance is coming off of North 9th.
So where I see retaining wall, that's where the entrance would be, correct?
Correct. Basically, where you see the handicap parking stalls that are there, the ADA stalls, and where that crosswalk crosses over to the ramp just in front of the building. The main door would be, if you're looking at the plan, just left of that, and there's an additional door just to the right. But the main doors from the parking area would be off that side of the building, kind of towards where the ADA parking is.
Gotcha.
There is parking off of the 9th Street, entrance on 9th Street too, correct?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
There's an entrance off of 9th Street also in the building.
Correct, there is, and there are stairs that are shown there, as well as a door you have right where you're pointing right now. But in terms of, you know, ADA access, that would be from the parking area on that side of the building. As you know, if you've been out to that site before, the building currently is elevated relative to North 9th Street and has a similar configuration.
And that elevation is going to be maintained?
Yeah, more or less. It'll be in that same general vicinity of finished floor elevation to what we had previously. Although, like I said, the building itself in the prior or in the existing condition is really kind of tucked up into that northwest corner of the site.
So by shifting the building, we'll call it down, and then to the back towards Moss Street, you're really clearing up. And what effect does that have on the overall efficiency of the drive-thru?
Yeah, like I said, it really helps us to be able to minimize the number of turns that you have there. Additionally, you can see, I think it's Mill Street on the north side of the page, which is more or less an alley between those residential properties. Right now, the way that that exists, there are bollards there that effectively block at that end of Mill Street to our property or vice versa. So in this instance, because we're able to shift the building down, we're now able to increase the width of that drive on the north side of the building where the effectively to be able to bypass the drive through. So we would be able to remove those bollards and allow access between the two. Although, you know, we consider that to be very minimal based on, you know, it's not really a main public thoroughfare kind of thing.
Yeah. Okay. So the drive through reconfiguration then is existing nonconformity.
Right.
And we are doing it primarily for, you know, the rebuild as well as an efficiency to make it run much smoother, make the customers come in and off the property in a much more efficient manner, correct?
That's correct. And now at this point, we really don't need to use, like right now, the site configuration of the drive-through actually utilizes a portion of Mill Street in terms of the where the right-of-way sort of dead ends there. Okay. That's effectively part of the drive-through as it exists today, whereas right now that would really just become part of the bypass.
Okay.
So
any complaints from your neighboring property owners about this new project or not?
We have not been made aware of any. And we do have a couple representatives from McDonald's here with us as well, but we've not been made aware of any complaints.
Before you move on, may I ask a question here, Catone?
Sure.
Yes, Jeff.
You made it, correct me if I'm mistaken, you made it sound like the entrance off of 9th Street is going to be the primary. Currently, people do enter from Moss Street. They enter, come down 9, come down Spring or whatever, turn in. I do it myself. I go there and I turn up Moss Street, turn in through that driveway and come around to your window. That's going to be there also. You're going to have 9th Street and also come in off of Moss.
Correct.
All right. And then they converge and they'll meet that way. Okay.
Correct.
At the turnoff.
Yeah. So the entrance points are effectively staying the same. You know, off the two streets with no entrance off this the side street. All right, Matt, let's just run through real quick. This is a special exception standard in the ordinance to allow the reconfiguration. And we went through that standard. Are there any specific standards for the reconfiguration of a non-conforming use in the ordinance?
Yeah, where is it?
I'm on page 4 of my There aren't any, are there?
No, there are no specific standards related to that.
All right, so let's go through the standards for a new drive-through, and that's at section 600-1004. And are you with those?
Yes.
All right, so let's just go through those real quick. And it goes A through E.
Correct.
The first one, A, it says a drive-through lane or canopy shall not be located within the required front yard. Is a drive-through within the required front yard?
No.
Okay. Number B, it has that you need to have a 2 feet separation from the drive-through from a lot line, other than provided in number C, which is some for some screening. Currently, do we meet that configuration?
In terms of the 2 feet from the line, no, we do not.
Okay, and then we've asked for a variance from that section later on, so we'll get to that one.
Correct.
But again, that's an existing nonconformity that we are maintaining, right?
That's correct.
Okay, we get to number C here. Drive-through lane, you must be no less than 10 feet from the lot with a buffer strip coming in. And again, we've asked for a variance from that section also?
That's correct.
And is that provision currently non-conforming as to the current conditions?
Yes.
And it'll effectively stay non-conforming as we move forward, right?
That's correct.
Okay. We have two more, D and E. D provides no canopy shall be less than 8 feet, 6 inches above grade. Do we meet that?
Yes.
Okay. And number E, all signage except direct clearance or directional signs are prohibited from portions of canopies that are located within the minimum setback. Now we do have some canopy signs to go through that, but they're only directional signs. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So we meet that aspect, right?
Yes.
Okay. So then let's go through real quick here for the general standards for the variance. Because again, we've asked for variance in the alternative from there. I'm sorry, I'm going to go to 6,612.01A. These are the general standards for special exception. I apologize. Pull that up. Okay, so the standards in section 1201A, there's 1 through 6. These are then the, we would call the general special exception standards. Are you familiar with those?
Yes.
All right, so the first one is, no special exception use shall be approved if it, A, one, substantially increases traffic congestion along a street or creates traffic safety hazard. Any increase in traffic or congestion or hazard created by the relocation of the drive-through?
No.
Okay. Number two, creates an undue concentration of population. Is that relevant?
No, there are no residential units being proposed here.
Okay. Number three, impairs an adequate supply of light and air to adjacent property. Any impact on that?
No.
Okay. Number four, creates a significant threat to the public health or safety. Any impact?
No.
Okay. Number five, it's detrimental to the use of the adjacent properties by generating significant nuisances or hazards. Any nuisance or hazard being generated by the drive-through?
No. Again, the reconfiguration of it actually moves it slightly further away from the, you know, at least in terms of that northern property line, moves it slightly further away from the existing residents.
So it's really an improvement from the existing conditions?
We believe so.
Okay. And lastly is number six. It meets the requirements of the standard for the chapter. Again, there are no standards just for the reconfiguration of the non-conforming use. But we did go through the standards for the drive-through, correct?
Correct.
All right. So that pretty much covers then the first request for relief, which is relocation of the drive-through, where we have a special exception being requested. Do you want to stop? Do we have any questions on that part before we move the signage?
So basically, you're just reconfiguring what's already there, not asking for really any relief because there's no buffering and whatnot, and you're making the situation with neighboring property owners better. Would that be a correct summation of it?
That would be a beautiful summation, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's move to signage then.
Okay. So let's go through signage. Do we have a signage plan to put up? This should be sent sheet Z0. There we go. Okay. Now, hopefully, you guys can read all of this. Matt, why don't you describe in general what's going on here? First, start with the little site plan, the letters.
Okay. Sure. Yeah, it may be a little bit difficult to see on here, but the signs themselves are noted and labeled on the drawing that you see in the upper left corner. And then the details of those signs are kind of in that center portion of the plan. So we have sign A that's noted here is really just a clearance bar that's in the center island of the double drive-through lane. So you can see there that clearance bar extends to both lanes. It does not really have any McDonald's branding or anything associated with it. And really what that's meant to do is make sure that if someone's coming around the building that they don't get around the other side of the building and hit the actual canopies over the drive-through windows themselves. So it's kind of a pre-marker, if you will, to make sure that you know only right-sized vehicles are going through that that portion. Moving down to, I'll kind of move through them in order here, A, B, D, you know, C, and so forth. B is the what they refer to as a pre-browse menu board. And again, those exist out there at the site today. There are two of them. They will be relocated along with the drive-through configuration itself, but not changed in terms of size or anything above what is there today. It will simply be a relocation. And really what that is meant to do is just give some, ability for folks to be able to see maybe some of the specials or some of the items that are listed there, so that when they get to the actual menu board, they're ready to go. It's really an efficiency type item. It's not meant to draw attention off the roadway or, be a big, McDonald's type sign that is drawing attention from the surrounding streets. It's really, directional and from an efficiency standpoint. C, which is just below A there, is the what is referred to as an order here sign. It's a canopy that extends over the actual order point. So if it were, if there were inclement weather, when you're there, when you open your window, there's actually a bit of cover. Again, no McDonald's branding or signage associated with it, but given the application that we made, this was one that was determined that would need to be part of the package and what we're providing here. Again, those exist on site today. There are two of them, and they will be relocated with the drive-through relocation itself. There are a couple signs there that are shown F and I, which are related to the building. I will note that none of the building signage is subject to zoning relief. We had requested, or we submitted the zoning applications, and really the only items that came back as part of a denial stating that we would need zoning relief were outside of the actual building. So any freestanding or directional type signage that we had. So G, which is on the far right side of the page there, is what's referred to as a roll forward parking sign. So if in the instance that a customer would get to the window, the pickup window, and their order wasn't ready, rather than holding up the entire line, they may ask that individual or that customer to move forward to, there's an additional window there, as well as some parking spaces up in that very northwest corner of the site, some of the angle parking that we have there. So we have two spaces, parking spaces, that are designated there that a customer could pull into, and then they would be able to bring their order out to them. If you scroll down a little further on the page, I'll just kind of run through the rest. Sign H is just a directional sign that will be placed at the main entrances and exits from the site. Again, from a customer efficiency standpoint, we want to make sure that people know how and where to get in and out of the site. Sign L is what is referred to as McDelivery. It's a courier parking spaces. There's I think two of them that are designated on the site right now, or on the proposed site, and those would be for people that utilize DoorDash, Uber Eats, something of that nature, and they could have a space for those drivers to be able to pull in. Now, I will note that if there was ever an instance where parking was unavailable on site, customers are allowed to park in those spaces and do from time to time. However, based off the uses of the site, we feel that there is sufficient parking. More and more people are utilizing the drive-through, and this type of a location where we have here has quite a bit of walk-up traffic, more so than people driving to it per se. Hey, signage is similar. It's a curbside pickup, so this would be for customers that order through the mobile app and then can come and pick up their order. And there are, I think, three that are shown on the site right now. They're basically on kind of either side of the ADA parking that's shown there. If you scroll further down, we'll go through the rest. Thank you. The window decals, again, are really just that's at the pickup windows themselves. Nothing McDonald's oriented. This is really building signage. Again, is not really subject to this application. And then sign M would be the freestanding sign that would be located at the corner of 9th and Spring itself, which is replacing the existing sign that's out there today. The existing sign that's out there today is at a height of 20 feet. This is also proposed at a height of 20 feet. I believe 15 is what's allowed. And then in terms of the overall area of the sign, the main McDonald's, what you see in red with the arches there shown at the top, that is 25 square feet. And then there is a digital electronic message center down below that that ultimately takes the sign size up to 42.08 square feet, whereas I believe 32 square feet is allowable for that overall sign. So it's about 10 square feet, but again, not markedly different in terms of what's out there today. I think really the only difference is that electronic messaging center.
Yeah. All right, so let's just go through the relief. The narrative, I think, sets it out nicely of which sign is subject to what relief. So hopefully you have the narrative which sets it off. So we'll start off with the freestanding directional signs, which is A, C, G, K, and L. And those are the signs which are first of all, subject to relief on here. And the limitations that we have a maximum area of 6 square feet allowed and a height of 4 feet. So if we go through the narrative, do you have it on here? You just want to, do you want to just run through that real quick?
I'm just trying to figure out exactly where on the narrative it is. So
sub 3.1, freestanding directional signs. There you go.
Yep.
Okay, so we have sign A, which is again, double clearway sign. It appears to be too tall and it's slightly too big, correct?
That's correct.
So then we go down to the next one, sign C. Again, it's the same height, 11.6. Its area is okay though, at 1.24 square feet.
That's correct. Yeah, it's 11.59 feet high.
And then sign C, D, and E, they're all the same size. However, they are at a height of 7 feet, which exceeds the 6 feet, correct?
That's correct.
And they are all at an area of 4.6 square feet as opposed to 4 square feet, correct?
Yeah, and again, I would note that that height is really driven by the fact that these are the signs that we were talking about in the, you know, the main parking areas there. That's to make sure that they're, you know, of a height that can be seen at or over the parked vehicles that are there. So, and those signs again are on site today. So a lot of this is kind of just part of the reconfiguration, but because we are completely redoing the site, they effectively told us, you know, that the existing nonconformities that exist out there, we would still need to come back for relief on.
Okay, and then let's go through the second batch and then we'll just go through the standards real quick. So the second batch of relief has to do with the freestanding signs, and that's sign B, D, and M, okay? So let's just run through what they have. B and D, they are both the menu boards that correct. We have on there. And within that area, we have a maximum height of 16 feet, an area of 32 square feet, correct?
Correct.
And both of those are compliant as to the area and height, correct?
That's correct. Okay. B and D, which is again those menu boards.
The menu boards. Okay. And then sign M, we have a height of 20 feet and then an area of 42 square feet. Correct?
Correct.
So the height is fine at 20 feet because we can go up to, it's 16 feet. So we're getting a variance from that, but that's existing height F.
It is the existing height, but yes, it does require a variance to, you know, effectively go back to that existing height.
Okay, great. And then as to the number of signs underneath with the ordinance, we are allowed one freestanding sign per lot, street, frontage. Okay.
Right.
So how many frontages do we have?
We have 3.
All right. So we're allowed 3 signs. And how many of these freestanding signs do we have?
We have five total. Again, they exist on site today, with the exception of the reconfiguration of the roadway sign, but that's two menu boards per lane. So there's four there, and then the one roadway sign.
So yeah, we currently have five of these signs, and we're going to replace it with five of the signs.
Correct.
But again, that's two over the allowable limit.
Correct.
Okay. So as to both of the signs, we've asked for two reliefs. First of all is a special exception pursuant to section 600-1725. And then in the alternative, we ask for dimensional relief related to those slight increases that we have. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right. So let's just talk a little bit about what's happening with the new signage that comes in here. So really, what's the purpose of all these new signs that we have?
It's really, again, from an efficiency standpoint, making sure the customers know where to go and the most efficient way to get there. We do have, you know, like I mentioned before, in a regularly shaped lot and a very tight space to be able to fit all of this into. So with that, we want to make sure that there's no confusion for customers.
And I want to point out in the upper left-hand corner of the drawing, as you can see on here, each of the signs are located on that plan, correct?
Correct.
So if you want to see where sign A is, you can look and you can find sign A on there.
Correct. There are labels associated with each of them, and you can see the corresponding letter call outs on each of them.
Okay. So for instance, if we do the main freestanding sign at the corner on the front, that's sign M, and there's an arrow pointing to what looks like to be a little slash.
Correct.
And that's the location of that sign.
Down in that southwest corner, correct.
Okay. Okay, so we're doing this as part of the rebuild of here. It's for the renovations and the modernization of the site, correct?
Correct.
And do these signs that are here, are they really necessary to make sure we have safe traffic movements on and through the site?
Yes.
Okay. And again, you had mentioned that these signs that currently exist would all be non-conforming under existing conditions, correct?
Correct.
And how would you describe the deviations that we're looking for? Are these large deviations, or are these small deviations from what's set out in the ordinance?
No, I think the deviations themselves are minimal. Again, we're trying to make sure that we keep the site as functional as possible. And like you said, given that many of these signs exist today, for customers that are familiar with the site, this is going to be what they expect to see as they're coming in and utilizing the new location.
Okay. And this will then be all consistent with the new look of the building that's coming in, as well as the building signs, which we don't see here, but it'll all be consistent as part of a unified package, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And what's the importance of the unified package of signage?
Again, just to make sure that people, if you go back in time and think of, you know, McDonald's of old anyway, where you could probably recognize it just by the building look itself. You know, we no longer have the red roof style, that you know, hip style roof. The building is much more modern, and maybe is not as easily identifiable as a McDonald's as it used to be back then. So the signage is really important to make sure that's identified. And again, given you've got a series of one-way streets around here and such, we want to make sure that people know how to get in, how to utilize the site, and then once they get into the site, how to maneuver efficiently.
Okay. And did you look at trying to make some of these signs either compliant, either area or height? Did you have a chance to look at that?
Yeah, we did. And again, this is a lot of research goes into, you know, the signs themselves and what needs to be there functionally to be able to make the site work as efficiently as possible, making sure that the menu boards are sized to be able to carry all the menu items that they have. You know, the pre-sell board being there again to make sure that when you get to the actual decision point that you're ready to go, kind of thing. So you know, the canopy clearance bar and the order here are not intended to be signs that you know, bring you into the site, but they are intended to provide convenience and make sure that you know, people are utilizing the site as functionally as possible.
And if the areas, because we have areas of a lot of the smaller signs, they're just over slightly, about 0.6 square foot. That extra area, is that really necessary to make sure that the message is being conveyed to the customer as they're traversing the site?
It is, yes.
All right. Okay, we talked then, so sort of the general variance standards on here. You mentioned we have an irregular shaped lot, correct?
Yes.
And this is part of the economic rebuild of this property, right?
Correct.
And it's necessary to kind of keep it up and modernizing from there. And would you quantify this as being a large deviation or small deviations?
I would say it's a small deviation from what's there today.
And would anyone going by, would you really notice that that some of these signs are, for instance, a foot taller or 0.6 square feet larger? Would be any noticeable difference?
No.
Okay. But there would be noticeable difference making it smaller that would have an impact on the efficiency of the full operation.
Yeah, it comes down, again, a lot of times comes down to size of lettering so that people can read, if they're in their vehicle still and traveling at some speed, that they can actually read what's there and know which way to go. And then again, when you're on site, being able to physically read, I've got my reader glasses on here because, it does become more difficult, the smaller that lettering becomes.
Okay.
If I may interject, the board is well familiar with signage. They hear about 120 cases a year. So we get it. We have your narrative. I think we could move forward.
All right. Let's talk finally. The last relief we have here is regarding buffering. If we could go back to the other plan sheet. Perfect. Okay. So we have three-dimensional variances that we've asked for back in this way related to buffering and screening. So the first one, which is the 104C, requires a 10-foot buffer located between the drive-through lane and a residential property on there. And it still looks like, well, first of all, is that met under the proposed conditions?
No, there are portions that do and portions that don't, similar to the configuration that we have here. The one thing I would note is that, this does speak specifically to the drive-through lane, and the drive-through lane itself is actually moving, further south away from and is in compliance with that. It's just the buffering that we don't have there. We are obviously adding back in some angle parking there, which we have two of them, like I mentioned previously, for customers that may need to pull ahead to keep the functioning of the drive-through working. And the other three that are back there are probably most likely going to be utilized for employees, for spaces, not typically for customers, because again, that is a little bit more difficult to access. But that area itself is one area that we will need relief. However, like you mentioned, it is an existing node.
So the overall drive-through, as you just mentioned, for the building, it significantly moved away from the neighbor property, correct?
Yeah, correct. And now giving us the ability to have that full bypass lane from effectively the end of Mill Street out to 9th.
Right. And we do have, there's sort of what we call like a pitch point the alley point.
Right.
Given the property lines, that there is a pitch point currently there where you're really zero or actually over it. Correct.
Yeah. Right at the, you can see a line there marked OH. That's an overhead line that runs across there. And yeah, down a little lower than where your pointer is right now, even a little further, is really where the curb line actually crosses into Mill Street. So there is a point there, right basically where your cursor is, where we have a very minimal, I think we listed out at about 1.9 feet or so, of distance. But then we do, as that drive-through opens up, as you head a little bit further east, we do have some area, we do have some landscaping proposed there. Again, that basically falls directly in line with where that curb line is.
So on the northern portion of the property, we have there, this is an existing condition. So that, okay, here we go. This shows this is the proposed conditions.
Correct.
We do have landscaping up along the northern portion, and those are marked on the northern property lines in the two areas, correct?
Correct.
And about how wide is that?
I think it's 4.8 feet from the back of the curb to the property line.
Okay. And both of those property lines, there's a a townhouse or a house immediately next door, correct?
Correct.
And those houses, do they have windows which overlook this property on that side?
On that side of the building, on either of them, no, I do not believe that they do based off of the information that I have. So again, we're not going to be making that situation any more detrimental to them or changing their view because they don't have a direct view from that side of it.
But there is landscaping being put in as much as possible.
Correct.
Along the northern areas.
Correct.
It's just that the area of that is not 10 foot, correct?
That's correct.
And if you would make that 10 foot, what would that do to the whole site layout?
If we were to make that 10 feet, I mean, really, we would not be able to have the drive-through configuration the way that we do. It would create an even further pinch point, probably effectively eliminating our ability to do a drive-through off of that side of the building. And then again, it would have kind of a ripple effect as you head further south and impact the traffic patterns in the site, impact our ability to meet the code as it relates to parking.
Okay, but you will be putting landscaping in there basically as shown on this plan here, correct?
That's correct. And you know, one of the things, and I don't know if we're gonna touch on it next, but you know, along the public street.
Yeah, well, that's the next one.
Okay,
that's the next one.
I'll hold on.
Okay, so the next variance we have is 1401C. That requires a 6-foot buffer along a public street where you have more than 8 parking spaces. So let's just go back real quick to the existing conditions plan. You flipped out onto that one. All right,
this is fine.
So we are looking, that is along Spring Street, correct?
Correct.
We're looking on there. And basically we have, there's some grass and there's some trees. Shade trees are located there, correct?
That's correct.
And is that constitute a 6-foot buffer currently?
It does. It actually extends out into the right of way. And as I understand from the ordinance that it allows for that buffer area to extend within the right of way portion. So we have the sidewalk that's there. That width is being maintained and that grass strip effectively is being maintained as well. What we are proposing to do is to replace the trees along that entire frontage there. And that was something that was discussed with the Planning Commission as well. But the trees that are there, you know, while they're mature, have actually had a detrimental impact to the sidewalk. We have several areas of sidewalk that have lifted out of their you know, typical space, which creates a tripping hazard and other things. So in order to be able to effectively rebuild that sidewalk, what we're looking to do is replace those trees with trees that will be more appropriate and won't have that kind of long-term detrimental effect to the sidewalk itself.
Okay. So the actual planning area is not going to be 6 feet, correct?
Correct.
So can we go back now to the proposed conditions?
Go ahead.
There we go. So this is what you talked about. We have the sidewalk area, and then we have the kind of the green area,
right?
Less, and then that's being replaced with a series of trees and shrubs.
Right, but I just want to note that, as I mentioned previously, the distance, the 6-foot distance, you know, from our curb line to our property line, we don't have that, but we do have that. You can see down the, call it the southwest corner there, it's marked at 6.2 feet. That's from the edge of our curb line, interior curb line where the parking is, out to the sidewalk. And then on the southeast corner, it's 6.4 feet. And that is, again, effectively creating that buffer, although it extends a bit into the right of way.
Okay.
It would fall in line with exactly the way that it is today.
Okay. So again, this is more of a I would call it a technical variance.
Sure.
It's kind of just rehashing the existing ones and reflecting the existing conditions that are out there, correct?
Correct.
So let's go to the last one regarding buffer screening. This has to do with the around the waste disposal area.
Mm-hmm.
Can you point out where that is?
Sure. It is in the, you're looking at kind of the northeast corner of the site directly right there. That is effectively the location of the existing trash enclosure as well. Although with the redevelopment of this site, that will be rebuilt as part of this. So the area behind it basically falls in line with what we noted previously, where we're, you can see the shrubs and plantings that we have shown just a little bit west of that enclosure. Really what's preventing that or preventing us from being able to do something there is there's actually an encroachment onto this property that is a, called an elevated walkway sidewalk, something that was created, we believe, based on the neighbor's property there that's been in existence for quite some time. I'm not aware if that accesses a doorway or anything there, but at some point along the way, it sounds like that was constructed, and we've effectively, you know, left that the way that it is, as they may utilize it. But it does create a pinch point for us to be able to add any additional planting specifically back there. I will note, you know, the actual enclosure itself will be fully screened. So it will still create a visual buffer, albeit not with landscape.
Okay. So in our current conditions, the dumpsters are within a structure of some sort, a wall or something, that you can't see the dumpsters when you walk by, correct?
Correct. From the ground level.
So the same thing, but there's no landscaping there. Right?
Correct.
So the same thing's going to happen in the proposed conditions. It will just be rebuilt in a similar fashion, correct?
That's correct.
So the relief we're requesting is really no buffering plantings in that area, because we have effectively the neighbor's sidewalk, which is attached to his house,
correct,
next door, that we are going to maintain.
That's correct.
And then, okay. All right, anything more on that part? Okay. I think that covers all the relief that we have. As for the last three, again, those are all dimensional variances. The board's very familiar with the standards are for variances, dimensional variances, especially as it relates to redevelopment of sites. These last three tend to be fairly technical things, points. We just wanted to make sure we had no issues with the rebuild. And they are basically maintaining the current conditions as to the ordinance, but they'll all be spruced up with either new structures or kind of a new design going through, but yet the same dimensional issues that exist will be maintained going forward. So with that, does the board have any questions for us?
Yeah, board members, I can't see you, but if you have any, please sing out and just ask your question.
I do have a comment. Apparently the Planning Commission has advised you that intersection at 9th and Spring is quite a meeting place. As you know, coming down Spring from 6th Street, they come there and they're not supposed to turn left. There's a sign says no turns, but they do. That's an illegal turn. I've called the police many times. They cannot do anything about that. So, and also across from you is a place where they sell beer and so forth. They double park there, which would be directly in line almost with your point of entry into your driveway. So just so you're aware of that, did they make you aware of that situation, that there could be a little bit of a bottleneck there with cars making that illegal turn and double parking? Or is that not a concern? That doesn't seem to be a concern.
Well, they did make a note specifically of the fact that there are no turns allowed there, which is why, again, we did reconfigure the driveway off of the rear property there. But as it relates to, you know, what happens on the city streets, it really is outside of our purview and our ability to be able to police it ourselves. I mean, to what degree that we as, you know, as a business in the neighborhood can, you know, try to keep people moving, or, you know, notify someone, hey, you're blocking out here.
No, I wasn't trying to be a fly in the ointment. I just want to say you have three really nice entrances, Moore Street entrance coming up from Penn Street on 9th Street going one way. They can enter that way. They can come down Spring Street instead of turning in Moss. They can turn right onto 9th Street and enter that way. It's just that one little situation where the people make that illegal turn and double park while they're picking up their booze. That could be a problem, just so you're aware of it.
We appreciate it.
I know when I was driving through the area, I did notice that the the driving and parking is quite all over the place, not just on this street, but all over there. So I think that's part of the neighborhood of how it operates.
Yeah, like McDonald's has been quite some time, so I think they're aware of some of those challenges, and yet you are willing to reinvest in this site, and we think that it is going to be a great improvement for that area.
I go there for hamburgers, by the way, so there you go.
I have.
Are there any other questions? Of the applicant?
Yes, I have a question, and then we'll take Mr. Jones. One of the things that they talked about in the staff report was a loading and an unloading zone. And I didn't notice that on the plans. I may have missed that. But what are you going to do about that? And one of the reasons I asked that question is there's a McDonald's near where I live and a couple of other places. And they bring those 40-foot, 50-foot tractor trailers in there. And the only place those people have to go is in the drive lane. And it really creates a number of issues. So I was wondering, you know, you may use different size trucks for different, for different areas, but I've seen that as a problem. And I didn't know if you have addressed that or considered how you're going to deal with that.
Yeah, why don't we swear in our the operator here. Say your name then.
My name is Stephanie Rawdon.
And can you get her sworn in?
Yes, would you swear?
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear the testimony about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Spell your last name.
Rawden.
Thank you.
And I will try to navigate this so you can see her a little bit better. I apologize.
That's fine. As long as we can hear her, that's fine.
Okay. There you go. How about that? Look at that.
That's so good.
So currently, because of the way the restaurant is configured and the size of the freezer and refrigerator we have, we get deliveries 3 times a week. With this new site and the larger capacity of the freezer and refrigerator, we'll be able to go down to 2 deliveries a week. And the way the deliveries are done now is the tractor trailer pulls on the lot. Everything comes in wrapped carts. It is rolled into the store very quickly. We have an actual direct door that goes into the freezer and refrigerator, and they're off the site in about 20 minutes. So it's very, very quick now, and we'll have one less delivery a week.
Okay, thank you. That answers my question. Now, Mr. Jones.
Yes, I believe you mentioned the number of seats that are going to be in the new building. What was that number?
I think it was 55.
55, yes.
Do you know how many seats are in the current building?
I
do not know either.
Okay, well, it's related to parking spaces. Do you know how many parking spaces are proposed and how many are they in meet the their current parking. Lot?
Yeah, the required parking is 20 on site, and we meet that. We have 20 proposed, and that's based off of the parking calculation from your ordinance.
Do you know how many are in the existing lot?
I don't know an exact number. It is slightly more. Again, the configuration of that lot was at such a time that, again, dating all the way back to when this was even before McDonald's, right? When it was a diner. Effectively, we are basically the main reduction in parking is along the south side of the existing building. There's parking that faces directly at the building itself.
22, I count. Oh, 22.
Yeah, there's.
I think it's about 29 or 30.
Yeah, so we're going down overall about, 9 or 10 parking spaces. But with the way that site is used, like I said, in terms of, a lot of walk-up traffic, drive-through traffic, we're comfortable with the 20 parking spaces as it meets the ordinance.
Okay, thank you.
I have one more thing I wanted to bring up. Are you going to run this restaurant 7 days a week, 24/7? That seems to be pretty much the standard, but I just wanted to know, are you going to continue that?
We are, and the restaurant currently runs 24/7. One of the efficiencies that we're going to be gaining, which is why we wanted to rebuild the restaurant, is having that third window. So as we are now, for security reasons, no one can leave the restaurant once the lobby is closed. So we don't have the ability to park cars if they have a large order or we're waiting on a product. Now with the new building, we'll have the ability to pull that car to the next window and ease up a lot of the tension in the drive-through. We'll be able to be much quicker, much more efficient because of the new setup of the building.
Okay, thank you. All right, any other board members have any questions? If not,
I just have something. Sorry.
Oh, yes. Okay, Emily, we'll take you first, and then Steve, and then I'll go to the audience.
Just going back regarding the loading and unloading space. So just to make sure I have it clear, the truck is just going to be pulling into that drive aisle. This right here, like off of 9th Street, they'll come in through here. They'll stop here for about 20 minutes to load and unload. Is that the plan?
Those three little doors that you see open there, that are there, one of those goes directly into the walk-in freezer refrigerator, and one goes directly into the stock room. And the other is to hold our CO2 tank, which is held outside of the building for safety reasons. And it's a very quick process now. The way that the carts come in, we used to unload case by case. They roll the carts in and the driver's off the lot very quickly.
Okay. But they will be basically using this drive aisle as kind of like the loading space, correct? Yeah. Okay.
Being used.
And that is, what's currently being used.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. All right. Anybody in the audience have any question? All right, seeing none, why don't you continue, sir?
This is Simon Wangolo, the planning manager from the city of Reading.
Okay. Tell your last name.
My last name is Wangolo, W-A-N-G-O-L-O.
Okay, go ahead with your question, sir.
It is more of a recommendation. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. One of the things that the planning office from the city did was to look at how the community will be using McDonald's once it is completed. And we found out that a significant number of the community members will be coming from home to go to McDonald's and will be going back home. Like, for example, we are talking about 37% of the people that are leaving their homes are going to McDonald's, and around 53% that are leaving McDonald's are basically going home. That gives us the highest number. Thank you, Emily. That gives us the highest number of the customers that will be going to McDonald's. Now, if you look at the rest of the people, like for example, people coming from work going to McDonald's are going to be 10.6. Coming from other stores, if you look at those numbers, are significantly lower than the people coming from home and those that are going home from McDonald's. As such, we are looking at how our community within the city of Reading can have an opportunity to be outside. And with that, we were recommending to McDonald's that as they think of this development, they consider the aspect of including the playground, especially for the young people who will be using their restaurants as the main customers, so that it is not just business, but it encompasses each and everyone in the community to be part of the development process. That is the recommendation I was wanted to bring to the board and to McDonald's as well.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's one of the questions we didn't get to yet, or one of the comments. And one of the things from the planning staff was they recommended a small playground for 3 to 10-year-olds. And I was wondering how you might be able to address something like that.
Because the property is so small the way that it is, McDonald's no longer allows us to build any type of outdoor playland. So they all have to be indoor. They're very, very large. I'm sure you've seen them on the fronts of buildings, and it's just not possible on the site that we have to build something of that square footage.
So there is no play area within the
proposal? There is no play area now.
Yeah.
And there's no area for it.
That wouldn't fit in there?
That would fit now. What are the square feet of those indoor play lands we have?
Gosh.
They've got to be.
They're into the 1,000, 1,500 square
feet. Yeah. The indoor play lands that we currently have, they're, 1,500 square feet. They have the big, 25-foot ceilings with the toy inside, and there just really is not room on this site for something like that.
Right. Yeah, I was looking at that after I saw the recommendations, and I know there's a place there that is designated like for water runoff. And I was thinking, I wonder if we had, some kind of a covering over it, that you might be able to do something there. But I also noted that a lot of the McDonald's dismantled those outdoor playgrounds and didn't really replace them with anything.
Yes, McDonald's no longer allows outdoor playgrounds. They've all been dismantled.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody on the board have anything else they would like to add or question or say? All right. Emily, any
That was it. Simon did a good job kind of summarizing everything. I know that we had brought it up previously at the Planning Commission workshop. So this was just good to know that, McDonald's does have kind of a minimum standard, and the site isn't conducive for their minimum standards for their play area. So I appreciate that clarification. And then, just about the loading area, it's something that they're already doing. So it's not, they're actually making it more efficient. They're having, as they stated, one less trip. So it looks like they're actually kind of reducing kind of that impact of not having a designated loading area. So I appreciate the clarification for that. Thank you.
All right. Anything from Mr. Price's office?
Mr. Price had to step out. I'm covering for him, but he does not have any further questions or comments.
Okay, thank you very much.
Your name? Can I get your name?
Yes, my name is Libby, last name Timura, T-I-M-U-R-A.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, you probably guys will be seeing me quite a bit.
Okay. Simon, do you have anything else you would like to add?
Not at this point. So I really appreciate McDonald's for the work they are doing, and thank you for giving us a detailed plan of how this process is going to be. I really appreciate it.
Okay. All right. Anybody in the audience have any question? Anybody in the audience want to vote for this appeal or speak on behalf of it? Anybody want to speak against this appeal? Seeing none in both of those cases, if the gentleman from Stevens and Lee, if you have anything else you'd like to add before we close this hearing.
Yeah, I just want to make it, I don't know, we made that point, but things got a little shuffled for the Zoom hearing. Matt here is a professional engineer from Bowler Engineering, and he is the engineer who was responsible for designing the plans. You see that, I believe you did sign and seal the plans.
That's correct.
That were on there. So just so you knew exactly what he was as a professional engineer designing these. And I think Matt himself, as you've designed 50, 100, how many have you involved
with
McDonald's?
Yeah, I've been involved with probably in that order of magnitude, but worked in the commercial land development industry for 25 years. Been licensed as a professional engineer since April of 2005. So I've done a lot of hearings like this. I know we didn't go through a formal qualification statement, but again, just wanted to note that this is something that I have a lot of experience in.
Yeah.
We would most likely have stipulated to that anyway. So
just want to make sure
Stevens and Lee has been around here for a while, so they would know to bring us anything who wouldn't qualify. All right.
Thank you very much. We certainly appreciate going through this, and hopefully look forward to a favorable vote at your next meeting.
Okay, yes. We will issue a decision at next month's meeting. You need not be here. The decision will be mailed back to you. And I think on behalf of the board, we want to thank you for an excellent presentation and a lot of excellent documentation. So thank you very much. And we will see all of you in July. It's hard to believe we're halfway through 2024 here in June. Emily, do you just want to let us on for just a couple of seconds and then we'll close out like we did before?
All right, I will stop the recording and then I'll set everything up.
Okay, thank you very much. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you.
You're welcome.